Hey everyone, welcome back. This is the part 3 of the WebRTC peer connection, in which I'm going to show you how to build a small application with JavaScript and HTML to share the video stream between the two peers. So I'll be using some few packages like Express, NodeMon, and Socket.io to create our socket, which will stand for our signaling service. So without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look what I prepared. So to first start up, we have to initialize the package.json. And let me first show the structure of the folder. So I'm inside the WebRTC app, which stores only the public folder. And if I go to the public folder, you can see is we have two files, client.js and index.html. So when I go to this client.js file, what you can see that I'm just taking this, accessing the HTML elements, the node elements. And when I go to the index.html, what you can see here is that I'm just basically creating a form for creating our rooms, and then just putting a div element to basically connect to the room and the button. I have also an UL element to store all the rooms that are available at the current moment. And I also have the div element, which stores all the video elements of the stream. So we have the video stream of the client, we have the guest, which is the person that is connecting to us. And we also have a button to hang up the connection, the video chat. On this line, I'm just accessing socket.io, which is necessary to be able to use the socket on the client side. When you go to the socket.io website and you go to the introduction, which is on the official site of the socket.io, they just explains what is the WebSocket, what are the differences between the socket.io and the WebSocket. And on the minimal working example paragraph, they explain how to install the socket. They also show you a small example how to initialize the socket on the server side. And you also have the example of the socket on the client side. So as you can see here, I just copied this line of code and I just pass it in my index.html file. And so what it does, it is Nix enables you to use the socket.io through your whole file. So basically, if you pass the source of this file, you are able to use the socket with the IO interface in your whole document. So again, the first step is to initialize the package.json. So I showed you the index.html, I showed you the client, and that's all I have. So I just wrote this code to save us some time. So basically, if I go to the application, the first step is to initialize the package.json. So I wrote npm init.i. And what it does, it will create for us the package.json. And so now we can run React Express. I'll just use the suggestion in the terminal. And so it will install for us the Express, the framework for the Node.js, the NodeMon for enabling the hot reloading of the server and the client side, and also the socket.io, which will it will basically work as a signaling service for our messages between the peer 1 and peer 2. So now we have to, let me just go back. So as you can see, inside our public folder, we have the two files. Right now, we have to create our server.js file. So I go to the server. You can see that this file is empty. So we have done the set number one, we have set number two, we have created our server.js, and so now we have to create our socket on the server and the client side. So right now I'm in the server.js file, and so what I do first is that we need to get the express, we need to create the express. And so now we can create an instance of an app. We call the function object express. We also have to create our HTTP server to be able to communicate through the socket. So we have to require the HTTP module from the Node.js. We'll create a server basically and pass our app from the express. The second step, so right now we have to create our instance of the socket. So let me call this IO and then require the socket.io. And as the second argument for the second function, we'll pass the server, the HTTP server. And right now we have to create our port to do the listening on the server. So I will just let me do environment process. Basically, process.environment. And whatever the port is, otherwise, port 3000. So we have our express application, we have initialized the server, HTTP server. We also have the IO socket instance, we have the port. So right now we have to enable our express application to serve the files from the public folder. So you can see that we have a public folder, and when I go to the public folder, we have the two files, and so I want to our application to be able to serve these files from the public folder. So I will just go and say app.use express.static, and so in this way you're just saving these files from the public folder. So right now we have to let us create our first socket. So get IO on connection, and then as a callback we get our socket instance, and basically let us console log a user connected to the socket, right? And as a last step here, let us listen on our server that we specified, and as a callback, just console log it. Let's just console a message. Server is listening. Right. So, right now, to basically run this, we have to specify a command for our node one, which will restart the server each time it will detect changes inside our application. So in order to do this, we have to go to the package.json file, and we have to basically create a new command which I will call dev. And as a command action, we will specify another one, server.js. And so from now on, whenever I just write yarn.dev, it will create for us our. Let's have to. There you go. So again, you can see the another one is starting, and this other server is listening on the port 3000. Right? So now you can see that this is basically the index.html file that I created. So right now it is not working as we want it to be. So you can see that it's doing nothing. So right now, let's just go to the, let's just open a new tab and go to our client application. So we want to start to basically catch if the user creates a new room. So we have to access our form and then create an event listener, which will be on submit. And then as a callback, we have a bind function with an event. And so first of all, we want to prevent the default behavior of the form so that our page will not reload, and then because we are not sending this form anywhere. And as value, or basically what I want to do first is I want to specify our stun servers, which will enable us to check our public IP address and all the information that are needed to establish the RTC peer connection. So in order to do that, we have to specify our internet connection established servers, which will be an object with a property of ice servers, which will be an object with another property of URLs, with a string of stun. And so if you want to get the stun server address, you can just type free stun address at URL addresses. So this was the first page that just popped up in my Google search. And so I just copy this URL. Let me just copy this one and then paste it here. So you have to always specify what type of URL is this. It can be a stun server on the or the turn server. So basically I'm just using the stun server to check the API, the public API of our connection. So the next step is to specify our peer connection object. So I'll just create a PC instance, which will stand for peer connection. And to create a new RTC peer connection, we're just calling this interface and then passing our ICE servers to create a new instance of the peer connection. And so right now, what I wanted to do next is I wanted to initialize our rooms. Let's just call it rooms list, which will be an empty array. I also need a local string, and I also need a current room. Alright, this is enough for now. And so let's go back to our form. Whenever the user submit a new room, we have to basically get the value of this our input which is start of the on the event object. The first element of it, which will be the input element and the value. So this is the value of our room. So right now we have to basically send it or emit this room to all the participants that are connecting to our socket. So what I'm doing here, I have to, I forgot, basically in order to use our socket, we have to first initialize the socket. So again, I'm creating a socket. I'm accessing the IO object, which is accessible globally thanks to the script that I added inside of the index.html file. So this line enables us to use the IO object through the whole file. So back to the client. So we have to now emit this room. So I'm just emitting a custom message. And as a value of this, we have to pass the value. Right. So right now we have to listen for this event on our server. So let me just create a new event listener or the socket listener, which will listen for the room. Whenever we get the room, we want to create a callback, which will emit the room to each participant that is connected to the socket. So basically, we have to access that our IO element, and then we want to emit this message of type of room to each user that is connected to our socket. So you can see that I'm just listening on the room event, and then on this line I'm sending this event to all the users. So this will send our room, and so we have to also listen for the room. So whenever the room message comes from the server, we want to basically store it inside our rooms list. So we have to call it rooms list that push, and we have to push a new value. And we also have to create the new element that will be to actually show it on the front end. So we have to create a new element, a li element, which will be list document or the list element HTML element. So I'm creating this element type li, and then we want to set the inner text as the room value, and we want to basically append it to our rooms list. But let me just, because I specified the rooms list on this line, I cannot specify it twice because we will have an error. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change it to rooms. And then I'm gonna say rooms list. And so in this way I'm appending this new element to our frontend in the index.html file. So if I save this, let me just save this file. So if I save this and I go to the our site. Right. And just right. So if I type a new room I created, we get an ally element Why is it so? Because we are appending element, not a string. So if I go back and I refresh the page and create a room, you can see that our two peers basically get the same room. So this is working. If I create another room, a third room, this is also working. This is all working fine. All right. So now what we have to do is basically we have to connect to the room. So to do it, we have to basically access the event of create an event listener whenever a user type a room number or the room name, and then goes to the connect, it will connect it, the user to the room. So what we have to do right now is we have to create an event listener. So we want to listen for the connect button and the click event listener, and as a callback function we have to take the value of the connect room input element. So we can specify it, or we can create our, let's call it room, or basically we have to set our current room to whatever the value of the connect room is. So this will set our value of the connect room input to our current room variable. So the next step is to basically send a join message to our socket to let other users know that we are connected to the socket. But first, I just wanted to show you the diagram that I created here. So when we go back to our setup steps, we have the initializing package data JSON, which we did. We installed the socket.io, express, and NodeMo. We have created our server.js file, and we have created our socket on the server and the client side. So here you can see a diagram, which will basically stand for a plan on which we have to basically, which will help us to, in order to create our RTC peer connection application. So the first step is that the user creates a new room and then join the room. Then the second step is that if the other user joins the room, then our signaling service will let know other peers that someone is connected to the room. The third step would be that to create an offer and send this offer to our signaling service, and then send it forward to the other users. Then the fourth step would be to receive this offer, create an answer, then send the answer back to the peer number two, this example. And the next step will be to store this answer as the remote description of the peer number one. And the last step will be to for both peers to listen on the new ICE candidate, which will be sent to the connection. So the first step is to create a new room and join it. So the first step is that we are creating this new room. And so right now we have to join this room. So I'm getting the value of the current room input, which is this one. And so whenever the user clicks on the connect button, we want the user to connect to this room. So in order to do this, we have to, first of all, we have to check if the rooms includes. Well, basically, there is a room inside of our array, then we want to send a message to the user, to basically alert the message. There is no given name. Right? And so basically, if the user type and room that doesn't exist, then we just want to return this function. So next step is to basically to get the user media. So in this line, we want to get the user media. And to get the user media, we have to access our navigator interface. Then we want to go to the media devices and then get user media. And we want to get the video element. So I'm setting it to true. But I don't want to audio element, so I'm setting it to false. Right. So what we will get from this one is basically a promise with a string. So this string I'm going to set as a local string, as the local object of our video stream. So this string will do access our client and the source object, which will be the stream. And we want to play this video. So this will set the stream object from our webcam and set it to our video on the web page. So after that, we can basically send a message to our socket that someone is connected to the room. And we want to send the current room. So right now, I have to listen for this message on the server. So I'm going to listen on the join message, whatever the room is. And so right now, we want to create a room for our sockets. So when you go to the socket.io website and you go to the rooms page, here you can see that you can create a room inside the server, which will store all the users that you specified, which will be the addressants, the basically the persons to which you can send the message. So, for example, you can create a room with two users, and only these two users will get the message that is sending inside this room. So, in order to create a new room, we have to call the socket.join method. And if you want to emit the message, you just call the socket.to, and then you have to pass the name of the room that you want to send the message, and then emit a method to emit the message. So let's go back to the server. And so let's just add this socket client to the new room. So let's just join this guy to the room. Well, basically I have to specify a new value of the socket room. So here I'm saying the socket room will be the value of our room. And so right now we can basically join this socket to our socket room. And so this will basically save the client of this on this socket to the room that we created, that we've created. So this will create our socket when we join to that. So the next step is to hide the inputs and show the div element with the video objects. So in order to do this, we have to basically get our dashboard element on the page, and we have to access the style and the display value and set it to none. And we want to also get the stream object and access the style value and display it as a block element. So this will basically hide all the inputs and show the video stream of the user. So let's just save this guy. Our server is running, right? So if I go to the page, I refresh this. I'm creating a new room. And I want to connect to this room. Basically get nothing. Get user media many devices. So I have another error. It is because I have a typo here. So I forgot to add an O to our video. And so right now, if I go to the website and refresh the page, this one, when I create the room and I connect to this room. So this is me, hello. And socket is on the function client 42. So the client 42 is like it's not a function. Because all right, because we if in order to send the message to our socket we have to basically emit the message. So this is it. So right now, as you can see, we have our step number one. So we're creating a new room and we are joining it. The second step is to join the room and let the other peers know it that you have joined the room. So again, basically I'm just transmitting this message to other peers. So right now we have to listen for this message from the server. So just saying, I'm listening to a new message on the socket. I'll get a room from this message. And so right now, what we want to do is that we want to check if the user is inside this the same room that the other person has joined. And so in order to do this, we have to check on the current room if it is the same. But basically, let's just say the current room isn't the same as the room that is coming from another user, then we just return this function. So we don't have to do nothing inside of it. So we'll just return this. Other way, we want to create our first offer on the RTC peer connection and send this offer to the user. First of all, we have to listen on two event listeners, which is the on track event listener on the RTC peer connection object, which will listen for the track elements that are coming from the another person, the peer number two. And whenever this event will be fired, then we get an event with the media stream of that user. And so we can store it as a remote video object. So we are listening on the on-track event listener, and as a callback, we can create a new function. Let's just call it at remote media stream. And then the second event listener that we have to listen on is that ICE candidate. So or on ICE candidate. There we go. So In this event listener, we are listening for the ICE candidates that are sent from the person on the other side, which will hold the information about the network, the IPA address, the port, and other necessary information to establish the connection. So, as a callback, we have to pass a function. Let's just call this function generate ICE candidate. Right. So, I'm just create this function right away, so that I don't forget to create them. So the first one is the add remote media stream, and so we'll get an event from this event listener. And so inside this function, I'll just add the event stream to our guest object on the HTML page. So I go to our index.html. We can see this line. I have a guest, a video object, and so I want this event stream to put inside this video. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to access this guest value and then the source object, and I'm going to pass the event, and on this event we have a streams array, and so I want the first stream object, which will be the video object. And I'm just playing this video right away. Right, so here you can see I have the first function of our event listeners, then the second function will be to generate the ICE candidate. Let's call this generate ICE candidate. Now we get an event list event object. And so right now we have to let us first check if the candidates exist on this event object. And if it exists, then we can create a new object. Let's just call this candidate. And so inside of this candidate object, there are few properties that we have to specify. The first one, which will be the candidate, which is the type of an object. The second one will be the label, which is stored on the event object, candidate, and then session description, media line index. And so what is this? What this object basically is that it is an index value of the media stream. So the first value will be, which is the first object on the streams, is this is zero. So the label in this example will be zero. The next step is to add an ID object, which is again on the candidate session description media ID. And then the next step is to basically pass the candidate as the candidate itself. So this will be on the candidate object and that candidate value. So after that, we can basically emit this candidate. So I can set a socket that emit, and so I'm emitting this candidate to other users, and then as an object, I'm passing our candidate that we've created. Right. We can also use console log a message. Let us console log a message of sending a candidate, and so pass the candidate object. Right. So we have our two functions on our event listeners. So the next step is to basically to add the track media on this peer connection object. And to add our media, we have to we have to call, we have to access the add track interface. And so add track interface, as we can see, it takes two arguments. The first one, which is a track, and the second one is a stream. So the track, which is the single, we can say single stream of the media object. So in this example, it will be just a lookout stream, get tracks. So I can get tracks that are currently on this object. And the first value, which is the video object. And as a second value, as on this argument, we have to pass our all stream property. So this is the way to add the track media. So right now we have to create an offer. So we are creating this offer. As a callback, we'll get the description object. And so we have to send this description to the other user that is connected inside our room. So we have to first set this description as a local object, or basically local description. So we can set local description, we can access it, and we can pass our description. So the next step is to we can also make a message setting local description. Right. Description. So right now we have to send this description to our signaling server, which will send this message forward to the other user that is connected to the same socket room. So I'm calling the socket and the emit action, and I'll emit an offer type of message, and I'm passing our description. Right, so far so good. Then I have to go to our server file, and then we have to listen to this event. So let's just create a new socket listener. So I will be listening on the offer message, and whenever the offer gets in, I want to send this offer to other users that are connected to the room or the socket room. Right, so this is the way to send the messages to all the users connected to the same room. So I'm going to emit this message, and this will be the message type of offer, and as an object which will read the offer. And so this way I'm sending the offer to all the other users. So on the front end, I have to listen on this message. So I'm going to listen on the offer, the other peer connected user. As a callback, we'll get this offer. And so again, we can basically just copy. We can copy this lines of code, because this will repeat itself. So here I'm just listening on the join message from the socket. So there are two basically ways of two cases that you want to handle. The first one is that the person is joining the room as a first person, and then the second person, which is joining after that. So you want to listen on the join messages and also on the offer. So let me just show you this diagram. Here you can see. So the peer number one on the peer number two creates the room and joins the room, but because there are no other users inside this room, there is no one to listen on the join events. So when the peer number one joins this room that our peer number two is inside of in the current moment, then the join message will be sent to the peer number two. And after that, this peer can pass create the offer and send this offer to the other user which will then store it as a local description, create an answer, and send this answer forward to the peer number 2. So this is basically just passing the messages with all the information that are necessary to establish the real-time peer connection. All right, so let's go back to this event listener or the socket listener. So right now I have to create the basically I have to set this offer as a remote description. So on this line I'm setting this description as a local description, but to set the other user description of it, of that RDC peer connection, we have to call the interface of set remote description. And to set it as a remote description, we have to create a new RDC peer object of the session description and pass the object offer. Right. So after we have set the remote offer as the description, we can now create an answer and send the answer to our socket. So right now we have to create an answer. So I'm creating an answer which will give us a callback, and then as an object we'll get this description. Then we can send it. We have to first set it as a local description. So I'll just set it as a local description. Then we can also console log it. Say that we have setting local description. And after that we can send it to our socket. So I'm emitting a message which will be the offer. Basically it is an answer. So I'm sending the answer to the socket. Of course it has to be description. Right. So right now we have to listen inside our socket on this new event which will be sent from the client. So we have to listen on an answer. As an object, we get an answer which we send forward to the other users that are currently in this socket room. So sending this to the socket room, I'm emitting a message of type of answer, and we can pass the second argument, which will be this answer argument, the object. So right now we can also listen on this event inside our client. So we are listening on the answer of the server, and we'll get an answer object and as a callback. We can basically we can set it to the as a remote description. So we can set it as a remote description, create a new RTC session description, and pass the answer to set the remote description. Right? So far so good. We have we are listening on the join events, we are listening on the offer and the answer. So we are sending the offer, we are receiving the offer, we are sending the answer, we are also listening for the answer. So right now we have to also listen on the candidates, because we are sending these candidates this line. Then we have to also listen to these candidates inside our socket. So inside the server.js file, I'm going to listen on the candidate message. And then as I go back, we will get this object and send it forward to our socket room. So I'm just emitting a message of the type candidate. And as an object, we will send the candidate. There we go. So we also have to listen on this new event from our server inside our plant. So we have to create a new circuit listener type candidate. And then we can take this candidate, or let me just call it as an event. Right, and then we can just get started. So we can basically create a new nice candidate object, which will have to be RTC ice candidate. As an object, we have to specify some values, some properties. So the first one will be the label, which is stored on the owner. We have to call it session description medialine index, which will be the event that label. Because as you remember, we have specified the label property on this line. So now we have to call it back and set it as the remote candidate. Then the second one will be the candidate itself. So we have to access the candidate. Right. So right now, I hope we can let this. So let us check the diagram and the steps that we have to take. So we are creating and we are joining the room. We are letting the other people know that we have joined the room. We are creating the offer and send it forward. Saving the offer, we are creating the answer to this offer and send it back to the other user. We are storing the answer as a remote description, and we are listening on the new ICE candidates. So we have taken all the steps that we have set it up before. So I wanted to add another another event listener for the Hangout button. Which will just reload the page to end the connection. So in order to do this, we have to set up a new event listener for the hangup element, and we'll be on click event listener as a function. We can callback, and we can basically call the location object and to reload the page. So this will reload the page for us. Right. So let's just save these files. Let's go back to the browser and see if we have any errors. Right, this one. So I'm creating a room. I'm accessing this room. And set, I'm accessing this room. And so I don't have our other peer object, video objects. So let me just see why this happens. Alright, I forgot to to basically set this candidate as a remote candidate. So we have to access our view connection object and then set the basically add as candidate. And after that, we have to add this candidate. That's the remote version of the internet connection establishment candidate, right? So right now, let us try it again. Let's refresh the pages. And I'll just say, to create a room. And access this room. Oh, I forgot to set the local stream as the stream that we get back from the navigator interface. So we are going to local stream and we are setting it as a stream value. Right, so I just save this. And let's go back to our page. So I'm creating a room and I'm accessing this room. On the other side, accessing the same room. Try to execute that. Let's try. So I had some typos in my code which I had to look up for a minute. So let me just explain you these typos that I made. So on this line, I just forgot to basically type correctly candidate. So I type candidate, which is not the right word for this. So we have to pass the candidate as well. And also on this line, I set a local description, which is not the right word for this method. So we have to change this to set local description, like that. And also on the server side, when I created a join event, I'm emitting this message to all the users. So what we want to do, we want to specify our socket room and send the message only to our users that are connected to the socket. So right now, when I save this file as well, and I go to my website and I reload the page. So I'm creating the room, I'm accessing this room, and on the other side, I'm accessing the same room. And so here we can see our RTC peer connection application is working. So I have two peers, which are exchanging the media. So if I hang up on this client, the one down below is basically over. So yeah, this is the application for this video. I hope you enjoyed this one. I will put the code with a link on the GitHub down below. If you have any questions, then put them in the comment section, and I will see you next time.